we have to talk about this first because it shook the NHL today, and I'm going to say the sports industry in general, the Chicago Blackhawks. So Stan Bowman stepped aside today. There's Stan because he was the general manager back in 2010. Was he the GM? He was the GM.
He was the GM.
For the Chicago Blackhawks in 2010, and there was a sexual abuse scandal that happened at that time. And not only was it swept under the rug for 11 years, but they did an internal investigation in Chicago at around the time and basically said, I think the quote was, they found nothing of substance. So now 10 years later, through the investigative journalism work of Rick Westhead and Katie Strang, let's give them massive shout outs for this because they were instrumental in unearthing this story. I'm using lots of big words.
Big words.
But following the findings and the conclusion of this new investigation, it was, what was it? It was Connor. What was the law office called? Connor and something, I think. Jenner and something. But through the new investigation, they found that there was very much sexual assault events and occurrences, allegations involving a former assistant coach from the Blackhawks in 2010. It was a video coach. His name was Adam. I don't even know his full name. It was Adam something.
Aldrich.
Thank you. Yes.
Don't want to give him too much shine though. So
that's exactly it. Right. Adam, Coach Adam was, he basically took advantage of one of the players who was on the team at the time. And it was well known throughout the organization that it had happened. I think it got reported it to some extent and the team was in a playoff run at the time and it was their first.
Brad Aldrich.
Thank you. Not Adam.
No,
it doesn't. It was the first playoff run that the Blackhawks had been involved in a long time. If you recall, they were pretty trash in the 2000s. The 2010s is when the dynasty started, of course. But they were in a playoff run and they wanted to focus on that and not take negative put negative attention on that. So they pushed it aside and a lot of other stuff happened because of that. And the player involved's career, his name's John Doe, according to the investigation, because they're trying to keep it as anonymous as possible. His career was essentially ruined after that. He never recovered, and there's a lot in the report that kind of explain the occurrences of what happened and the timelines. And it's 107 pages. I checked. I didn't look at all of them. I read a bunch of reports as much as I could on Twitter today, and it was all over. So if you're just finding out about this, check Twitter, check Google. There's a ton of stuff, and the report is public, so you can go actually read the entire thing. And it is damning, I'll say that, to all involved, and it doesn't look good on any of them, including and not limited to. General manager of the Winnipeg Jets, Kevin Cheveldayoff, and head coach of the current Florida Panthers, Joel Quenneville, who was the head coach at the time. Also, Mark Bergevin for the Montreal Canadiens was there. I didn't see him named as often or as much as the other guys, but he was there, very much there. And there were several other high-ranking executives that are still in and around the NHL today that are involved in this. The Chicago Blackhawks were fined $2 million, and Max, I'll let you talk about that in a sec. So you can take over in a minute here because I'm almost done. They were fined $2 million, which I guess they're going to allocate to sexual abuse programs around the Chicago area, which I guess that's good in a sense. But Max, this is a stain on the NHL, this whole thing. And would it have been better if they came out with this 10 years ago? Yeah, but no. Obviously, no. It wouldn't have been better. It would have been. I don't know what you want to say about it, but I don't know, Max. I know you have some thoughts, so I'll let you take.
Yeah,
over.
I mean, regardless of the timeline of when it comes out, this is just horrible events. And as you said, Clark, it's a stain on the NHL as a whole. It's a stain on one of the original six franchises. Who, when you look at, I guess the league's values and ethics and what they put in terms of the marketing slogans, they didn't live up to any of it in this situation, especially from the NHL standpoint. it's not to make a joke of it, but we're going to call this the Houston Astros treatment. Obviously, a very different set of circumstances when it comes to the allegations and the crimes that were committed. But when it comes to this situation as a whole, $2 million to a franchise that's worth over $1 billion, this is absolute joke of a penalty. They should be forfeiting something that actually affects the building of this team in the future. Draft picks, whatever you want to call it. And regardless of that, the hockey aside, this is somebody's life that we're talking about. This is somebody who, regardless of the career...
And more than one person.
And more than one person as well. But obviously the main subject of this investigation, as you alluded to previously, the John Doe, as it were, the subject of the 107-page investigation findings today. This is somebody's life. This is somebody's... Again, we talked about hockey career, but somebody who has to live with this for the rest of their lives, and how do they move on from this, right? It's 11 years later, but at the end of the day, this is still somebody who went through something incredibly traumatic, who you don't wish on anyone. And to see it happening at the highest level, when this is a league that takes pride in being role models for kids, the ripple effect it has across the entire NHL, nobody lived up to anything here in terms of a good
accountability.
Good standing. Yeah, zero accountability, exactly.
Team CEO Danny Wirtz said in a quote today that no member of the Hawks senior management team, I think from that time, will be with the organization any longer. So they have either stepped down or been removed from the team. Anybody that was involved, because they have been a franchise of continuity. They've kept around several members of that executive staff, and there's several people that were named today that are no longer with the team. And again, it's going to have ripple effects across the league, because we've seen it in years past when a team wins, especially like the Blackhawks did for 3 or 4 years, 5 years, I guess it was, those assistant general managers get manager spots. Those assistant coaches get coaching spots. Things happen and they move around. And so everybody involved we're going to see a statement from the Jets, I believe, within the next couple of days.
Kevin Cheveldayoff, they're unearthing some things that were said at the beginning of this investigation that clearly were not true.
Right. Well, because Cheveldayoff came out and essentially said a couple months ago, this is the first time I'm hearing about this.
As did Joel Quenneville.
Quenneville said the same thing. It's the first time I'm hearing about this.
Again, it's just a smearing and an indictment of integrity across a lot of people who were held in very high regard, not just in the Chicago Blackhawks organization, but across the entire NHL. And at the end of the day, you call it what it is, but this is a major lapse in judgment, a major lapse in discipline handed out. Yeah. This is just a bungling all across. And again, like we said, we talk about the hockey side of it. The hockey side of it's really not important at the end of the day.
For reference, to add to your bungling of the discipline and the fine and $2 million, when the report came out today, there was comparisons to other things that the NHL has done, handed out fines, etc. When the New Jersey Devils tried to sign Ilya Kovalchuk to that contract that was illegal, they fined them $3 million.
Yeah.
And also, they lost draft picks, I'm pretty sure, for that.
Yep, maybe.
Was that when they tried to get Kovalchuk, when they tried to get him retired, or they tried to
retire him
or something?
Again, then, right? I think at the end of the day, whatever the penalty was, you're right. It was $3 million was the basis of that, right? And again, it speaks to, it's kind of, again, a situation where it's relatable. It's all about the hockey when they hand out these fines, right? They're not thinking about the actual individuals that are affected by this outside of the rink. And that's what bugs me about it the most. Mm-hmm. You look at it, and I mean, at the end of the day, it's just a horrible situation. And again, for an original six franchise that was a foundational pillar in assisting the league in what it has become today. This is a massive, massive stain across the entire NHL for a variety of reasons. It's hard to put a lot of words to it. And at the end of the day, I feel for John Doe and all of the other people that were impacted by this decision. I think the other biggest thing, Mark Messier said it very, very well before the Predators and Sharks game on the ESPN Plus panel. The thing that is the most sad about this is references were handed out for this individual, the coach in the situation, to have another job and commit similar crimes in another organization. It's just horrible on so many fronts, and how mishandled it was. It makes you shake, right? It hurts as a hockey fan, as somebody who idolizes the NHL, somebody who spends money purchasing gear and purchasing memorabilia and lining the pockets of it. Sometimes it just can't be just about the hockey, and this is exactly what this situation stemmed from. And unfortunately, this is going to be something that it's talked about for a long time. And I really, really hope the NHL revisits what the sanctions and the penalties are going to be handed out here, because
or like
we talked about
adds on to it for some reason.
Oh, exactly. We talked about the correlation, right? You mentioned it. And Arizona, I think that was the next situation that you were going to allude to, was they lost draft picks for violating some scouting and
some
recruitment violations.
The way they did their workouts,
but
was
yet
wrong.
This only warrants a $2 million fine for an organization worth over $1 billion. It's a joke.
And on top of that, too, and one thing that will be talked about more and more in the coming days, and interesting timing that the Maple Leafs are in Chicago this week, mm-hmm. media, I'm talking about media-wise, mm-hmm. The players aren't not at fault here either.
Absolutely.
We talked about this before the show, Max, mm-hmm. but players who are still in the league currently were on that team knew about this. Jonathan Toews, Patrick Kane, Duncan Keith. I mean, Brent Seabrook is technically not retired, but mm-hmm. he's still around. You know, guys like Dustin Byfuglien were on that team. Andrew Ladd was on that team.
Leadership from top to bottom.
Christopher Stieg, I think, was on that team. The list goes on and on. There were some great players, of course. And, you know, how much have those players been thinking about that over the last decade? How much has that led to some issues that maybe we weren't aware of that it was connected to? So that's probably going to come out more and more in the next couple of days, especially, like I said, Jonathan Toews and Patrick Kane are both not playing Wednesday night against the Maple Leafs because mm-hmm. of COVID reasons. Interesting timing. But they are still available for the media, so I'm sure that they're going to be answering questions about this soon, and more will come out of this of the next couple of days. But mm-hmm. again, I'm going to speak for you, I think, in saying this, but again, thank you to Rick Westhead, Katie Strang, and all the journalists that were involved in bringing this up and, you know, kind of bringing this to, I don't know if it's done yet, but bringing this to some sort of justice and some sort of...
For bringing it out of the dark.
Conclusion. Bringing it out of the dark, exactly, mm-hmm. and bringing light to it. Thank you, Mac.